This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, very good morning to everyone. Today we discuss about salivary glands, anatomy and physiology. Okay, this is the overlay of the today's discussion. First introducing the glands, next classifying embryology, anatomical and clinical implications, which we will deal in the other class. Next physiology. Okay, first water glands. A cell or group of cells or organ that selectively removes material from the blood, concentrates or alters them, and secretes them for further use in the body. Glands for elimination.
Aim story.
Typically, a gland consists of either cuboidal or columnar epithelium resting on a basement membrane and is surrounded by a plexus or meshwork of blood vessels. Okay. So, coming to the types of glands, these are endocrine or ductless glands. Like you see in pituitary, thyroid, adrenal, these secrete substances known as hormones directly into the bloodstream rather than through ducts. Next is the exocrine glands. Example are salivary glands, sweat glands, and digestive system glands. They discharge their products through the ducts. You can see here. This is the exocrine gland. Okay. This is the endocrine gland. So, types based on ductal pattern. Exocrine glands based on ductal pattern, they are divided into simple types and compound types. Simple types are again subdivided into tubular. You can see this is simply only tubular. This is branched tubular. This is coiled tubular. This is branched alveolar. You can note here, alveolar. Okay. Coming to compound types, multiple will be there. Multiple branches will be there. Tubular and alveolar. Coming to proper salivary glands are a group of exocrine, mirocrine, simple or compound tubular acinar type of glands secreting saliva. Here the mirocrine means the secretions from the cells through exocytosis directly enters into the duct. Okay, these are called as mirocrine glands. Salivary gland is a type of mirocrine glands. Other types of glands are mirocrine, holocrine and apocrine glands. So the saliva forms a film of fluid coating the teeth and mucosa, thereby creating and regulating a healthy environment in the oral cavity. The oral fluid, which is referred to as mixed or whole saliva, includes the secretion of major glands, minor glands, desquamated oral epithelial cells, microorganisms and their products, food debris and serum components, and inflammatory cells that gain access through the gingival crevice. So, how do we classify salivary glands? Based on the size, histochemical nature of the fluid, ductal system. Based on the size, there will be major and minor salivary glands. Major salivary glands, as you all know, these are parotid, submandibular and sublingual glands. Minor are retromoral or called as Karmal's glands, glands of von Ebner, which are present in the back of the tongue. Others are glands of lips, cheeks, heart palate. Next type is according to the nature of secretions. Either it might be a pure serous or a pure mucus or a mixed. Pure serous here, parotid, glands of von Ebner. If you can't remember the minor salivary glands, just remember major. Parotid is a pure serous. Pure mucus are anterior lingual glands of Blanding and Nunn. Mixed are submandibular and sublingual. So parotid is a serous, submandibular and sublingual are mixed. So according to ductal system, simple will be minor salivary glands, compound or major salivary glands, because it has more branchings. Coming to embryology, First, you'll see the image and then we'll come back. You can see here, initially there will be a solid downgrowth from the epithelium. From this, there will be multiple branchings initially. Okay? These branchings will be canalized here. Canalization of the ducts will be present. Next, there will be formation of SNI from the terminal parts of the ducts. So the individual salivary glands arise as a proliferation of oral epithelial cells forming a focal thickening that grows into the underlying ectomesenchyme. Continued growth results in the formation of a small bud connected to the surface by a trailing cord of epithelial cells with mesenchymal cells condensing around it. Formation of clefts occur forming two or more buds. Next, continuation of this process occurs called branching morphogenesis, produces successive generation of buds and a hierarchic ramification of the gland. Branching morphogenesis, defined as growth and branching of epithelial tubules during embryogenesis, is a fundamental feature of renal, lung, mammary glands, submandibular gland and pancreatic morphogenesis in mammals. The same image which I previously discussed. So, coming to the glands and from which intrauterine life they start to grow. Parotid gland location is corner of sternum. From 6th week of intrauterine life, they start. Next, submandibular gland location is floor of the mouth, end of the 6th week of intrauterine life. Sublingual gland is lateral to submandibular primordium. From 8th week of intrauterine life, they start. Minor salivary glands, location is buccal epithelium, from 12th week they start. The cells of secretory end pieces and ducts attain maturity during the last 2 months of gestation. You can broadly remember from 6th to 12th week they start, and by the end of the last 2 months of gestation, they attain the maturity. Next, coming to microstructure of the glands. This is very much important. You have to remember this, because why pleomorphic adenoma is called pleomorphic? All these are based on this only. Tumor from which cells it arises, you should remember. If you can remember this microstructure, then you can easily remember all the tumors and this originating site. The broad microstructure of the glands are secretory units called SNI. Okay. Next is myoepithelial cells. Next are ductal units. Next comes, as usual, connective tissue. So under secretory units SNI, there will be either serous cells or mucous cells. Myoepithelial cells are same. Ductal units, there will be intercalated ducts, striated ducts and excretory ducts. There are also interlobular ducts and intralobular ducts, and we see data. In connective tissue, there will be surrounding capsule, tissue septum and tissue elements. So remember all this. Secretory units SNI, myoepithelial cells, ductal units and connective tissue. These four are the microstructure of your glands. You can see here. These are the myoepithelial cells. These are the intercalated ducts. These are the striated ducts. These are intercellular canaliculus. This part. As usual, this is the lumen. So myoepithelial cells, see, these are present here, there will be interconnected duct and there will be secretory end piece here. These are the secretory cells. Coming to description, contractile elements associated with the secretory end pieces and interconnected ducts. Stellate shape, numerous branching processes which envelop the secretory end piece. Fusiform shaped with fewer processes. These processes are filled with actin and soluble myosin. Contraction of these processes provides support to the end pieces during active secretion of saliva. Recent evidence also suggests that these cells provide signals to SNR units to maintain cell polarity and structural organization of SNI. If you can't remember this matter, just remember the image. So we have previously discussed the ductal elements, no? This is the pure serous SNI, this is the mucous SNI, These are both mixed acid. So from this acini, the secretions are secreted and then this is collected by the ducts. Okay. So from the acini, initially the secretions are collected through intercalated ducts. Okay. From intercalated ducts, the striated ducts. From the striated ducts, the excretory ducts, which are either Stenson's and Watson's ducts respectively. These are the broad three, main three, but there will also be intralobular and interlobular. Okay. And remember that intercalated, striated, intralobular, interlobular, excreted. Okay. So intercalated ducts are single layer of cuboidal cells. Secretory units may also secrete lysozyme and lactoferrin. Striated ducts are constitute largest portion of ductal system, columnar cells. A modification of primary saliva by reabsorption and secretion of electrolytes. Terminal excretory ducts are pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Other types of cells like tuft cells, lymphocytes and macrophages may be present with it. Coming to anatomy first. Parotid gland. You can see this is our parotid gland. So this is the largest serous salivary gland. It weighs around 15 grams, resembles a three-sided pyramid with apex directed downwards. So coming to parotid capsule, formed by the investing layer of deep fascia. This is the capsule part. Is formed by the investing layer of deep cervical fascia. The fascia splits to enclose the gland. Okay, let us see. You can see here the fascia splits to enclose the gland. This is the parotid gland. Next. Superficial lamina, thick and adherent, is attached to zygomatic arch. Deep lamina, thin, attached to styloid process, the angle and posterior border of ramus and tympanic plate. A portion of deep lamina thickens to form the stylomandibular ligament, which separates the parotid from the submandibular gland. Coming to parotid gland and its relations. Okay. Superior surface, there will be concave related to cartilaginous part of external acoustic meatus, posterior aspect of temporomandibular joint, auricular temporal nerve, and superior temporal vessels. Apex overlaps the posterior belly of digastric and adjoining part of carotid triangle. Superficial surface is covered by skin, superficial fascia containing facial great auricular nerves, superficial parotid lymph nodes and posterior fibers of platysma. Andromedial surface relations are grooved by posterior border of ramus of mandible related to mesiter, lateral surface of TM joint, medial thyroid muscles, emerging branches of facial nerve. We can see the posterior medial surface is related to mastoid process with sternomastoid and posterior belly of digastric. You can see this is the mastoid process and sternocleidomastoid. Styloid process with structures attached to it. External carotid artery, which enters the gland through the surface. Internal carotid artery, which lies deep to styloid process. We can't make out all the relations in the image. This is the broad image which I have already discussed now. So, if we come to parotid, there are some structures in the parotid which are present within and these should be preserved. Okay. Usually we will not encounter arteries during our surgery because it will be deeper. So what are the structures within the parotid gland? Coming to first the arteries. Remember the image, external carotid artery, the posterior auricular artery, the superficial temporal artery, maxillary artery. Okay. These are the present within inside. Okay, coming to the veins. Remember this image. The transverse facial vein and the superficial temporal vein joins the maxillary vein to form the retromandibular vein. Okay, this retromandibular vein is divided into anterior division and posterior division. Okay, this anterior division of retromandibular vein and the facial vein combines to form the common facial vein. This posterior division of retromandibular vein joins the posterior auricular vein and drains into external jugular vein. Okay. This is most important because retromandibular vein is related to facial venous fatty. So you have to remember this venous drainage also. Coming to the nerves. Till now we have discussed regarding the structures within the parotid gland. So these are the nerves present within the parotid gland, not the nerves supplying the parotid gland. You already know facial nerve divides into pes transversus. Initially it is broadly divided into two branches initially. See, this is upper branch and this is the lower branch. This upper branch gives again temporal and zygomatic branch. The lower branch gives common buccal branch, which is again divided into upper buccal and lower buccal branch. The other two branches are marginal mandibular and cervical branch. You have to remember this. So we have to preserve the facial nerve during the parotid surgeries. This is the patis facio venous leg. Large superficial and small deeper part. You already know that parotid has a superficial part and the deep part. The superficial will be large part and in between will be isthmus and small deeper part. Okay. The facial nerve divides along this plane. So what is this clinical significance? The facial nerve must be traced from behind forwards as it emerges from the stylomaster foramen and enters the parotid gland. The nerve is surrounded by leash of veins called the neurovenous plexus of Patti, which must be followed with fine dissection, preferably under a microscope to surgically divide the isthmus. So the meaning is, from inside outside, that is from deep to superficial, there will be artery, vein and nerve. So if we encounter any bleeding, that is severe bleeding from the veins, that means you have already injured the nerve. So we have to be careful regarding this. So in parotids, patis facio venous plane is very much important. We can see here, this is the superficial lobe of 80%, deep lobe is only 20%. In between will be isthmus. In surgeries, we cannot make out the isthmus very clearly because it will not be this much broad. So one more important structure is parotid duct or ductus parotidus. Is also called as tensor structure. So this is thick-walled and about 5 centimeters long. You can see here, this is the parotid duct. Okay. Emerges from middle of the anterior border of the gland. Superior relations are accessory parotid duct, transverse facial vessels, upper buccal branch of facial nerve. Inferior relations are lower buccal branch of facial nerve. So, at the anterior border of the masseter, the parotid duct turns medially and pierces the buccal pad of fat, buccopharyngeal fascia, buccinator. The duct runs forward for a short distance between the buccinator and the oral mucosa. Finally, the duct opens into the gingival buccal vestibule opposite the crown of the maxillary, second molar tooth. You can see here. Opposite to the crown of the second molar tooth, the duct opens. This is the surface anatomy of the parotid duct. Corresponds to middle line drawn from the lower border of the tragus to a point midway between the nasal ala and upper labial margin. This roughly corresponds to our parotid duct. So coming to the arterial supply and venous drainage of parotid gland. Arterial supply is external carotid artery and its branches within the gland. Venous drainage is drains into external and internal jugular veins. So parotid gland nerve supply is secretory motor to the parasympathetic, reaches through auriculotemporal nerve. We should remember this. Nerve supply of parotid is secretomotor nerve supply is through parasympathetic. Okay, don't forget this one and don't tell facial nerve supplies parotid nerve. Facial nerve is only related to parotid nerve. So first nerve supply of the parotid gland, this is the secretomotor nerve supply. So first it comes from inferior salivary nucleus, later through glossopharyngeal nerve, tympanic branches, through tympanic plexus, joins the lesser petrosal nerve. These relay in otic ganglion. So otic ganglion supplies also the lacrimal glands also, apart from parotid gland, okay, otic ganglion. So this is the preganglionic fibers. From the otic ganglion, the postganglionic fibers pass through the auriculotemporal nerve to the parotid gland. Other supplies are the vasomotor supply from the sympathetic nerves and the sensory nerves. So the vasomotor supply is derived from the plexus around the middle meningeal artery. Sensory nerves are derived from auriculotemporal nerve, but the parotid fascia is innervated by the sensory fibers of great auricular nerve, C2-C3. Coming to lymph nodes, parotid lymph nodes will be present within the parotid gland, and the parotid gland drives to the parotid lymph nodes initially. These lie partly in the superficial and partly in the deep fascia over the parotid gland. These also drains apart from the parotid gland to the, from the temple side of the skull, external caustic meatus, middle ear, parotid gland, upper part of the cheek, and parts of eyelids and orbit. So that is a broad description about the anatomy of the parotid gland. Now coming to submandibular gland. You can see here, this is the submandibular gland. This is the superficial part and this is the deeper part, and the shape is J-shaped. The location is anterior part of the digastric triangle, size of a walnut, roughly J-shaped. The superficial part is large part, filling of the digastric triangle, extends up till the mylohyoid line. This is the mylohyoid, okay, till the mylohyoid line. It has inferior, medial and lateral surfaces partially enclosed between two layers of deep cervical fascia. This is the anterior belly of the digastric. Inferiorly, there will be skin, platysma, cervical branch of facial nerve, deep fascia, facial vein, submandibular lymph nodes. Laterally, there will be submandibular fossa on the mandible, insertion of medial pterygoid and facial artery. Medially, there will be mylohyoid, hyoglossus, styloglossus. This is the hyoglossus. Okay, this is the mylohyoid, medial. Deeper part is small size, lies deep to mylohyoid, superficial to hyoglossus. You can see here. This part is the deeper part. Okay. This is the mylohyoid, this is the hyoglossus. Lies deep to mylohyoid and superficial to hyoglossus and styloglossus. You can see here hyoglossus in this image. Coming to relations, laterally the mylohyoid, inferiorly hypoglossal nerve, medially hyoglossus, superiorly lingual nerve with submandibular ganglion. So duct present, duct draining the submandibular gland is Martin's cell. Thin wall, about 5 cm long, emerges at the anterior end of the deep part of the gland, crossed by the lingual nerve at the region of anterior border of hyoglossus. See, this is the bottom stuff. Okay, arising like this from the submandibular gland. If you can note here, see, this is the lingual nerve. Okay, it crosses the lingual nerve at the region of the anterior border of hyoglossus. Okay. Opens on the floor of the mouth on the summit of sublingual papillae at the side of the tongue frenulum. So coming to blood and lymph supply, supplied by the facial artery, veins drain to the common facial or lingual vein. Lymph passes into the submandibular lymph node, that is one vein. From there it drains to 2, 3, 4. See, this is the gland. Relation of the facial artery to the submandibular gland and to the mandible. See, you have to remember this because during submandibular gland excision, facial artery will encounter it. Okay. And relation of the facial vein to the submandibular gland. We have to carefully ligate, or else there will be severe bleeding. So, same. Like parotid gland, submandibular gland also has secretory motor fibers from the parasympathetic ganglion, sensory fibers from the lingual nerve, vasomotor supply from the sympathetic fibers from facial artery plexus. In parotid, that is inferior salivatory nucleus, but in submandibular, there will be superior salivatory nucleus. Okay, from superior salivatory nucleus through nervous intermedius. Facial nerve from the caudate tympani, this joins the lingual nerve branch of trigeminal. There they form submandibular ganglion. This is the preganglionic fiber. From submandibular ganglion, the postganglionic fibers reaches the submandibular and sublingual nerves. This is the secretory motor. So coming to sublingual glands are the smallest of the three salivary glands. These are almond shape and weighs about 3 to 4 grams. About 15 ducts emerge from this gland. Most open directly onto the floor of the mouth, while some join the submandibular duct. This is the sublingual gland. This is the submandibular duct. Others are, you can see, mylohyoid. This is the tongue. Okay, this is the mandible. Genioglossus muscle, anterior belly of digastric. So, blood supply to the submandibular gland, sublingual gland is lingual and submental arteries. Nerve supply is similar to submandibular gland. Coming to minor salivary glands, they are located beneath the oral epithelium in almost all parts of the oral cavity except in the gingiva, anterior heart palate, and anterior tubers of the tongue dorsum. 600 to 1000 in number, present in small clusters of secretory units, classified according to their anatomic location. Continuous slow secretory activity will be present in them, often supersede the activity of major salivary glands at night. So some of the minor salivary glands are glands of Blandin and Nunn, mostly located near apex of the tongue, somewhat found posteriorly, chiefly mucus. Anterior glands open on ventral surface near the lingual frenulum. Posterior glands open on the tongue dorsum. Glands of Von Ebner, located on posterior aspect of the tongue. Exclusively serous. These functions are washout of propapillar, radiating taste receptors for a new stimulus, antibacterial activity, lipolytic activity with significant activity in newborn when pancreatic lipid activity is low. You can see here, these are the Von Ebner glands. So coming to physiology of salivary secretion, about 1 liter per day of saliva is secreted every day, that is 0.1 to 4 ml per minute, varying from rest to stimulation. Constituents are 94 to 99.5% is water, 0.5 to 6% is solids, the remaining is gaseous. So from solids, again, there will be inorganic and organic. Organic and organic micromolecules will be present. So functions of saliva, they help in lubrication and protection, buffering and clearance, maintenance of tooth integrity, antibacterial activity, taste and digestion, excretion of certain drugs and inorganic ions. So how is the salivary secretion? Either through active transport process under neuronal control or osmotic process. So control, stimulation of parasympathetic nerves liberates kallikrein from the gland cells, which acts on plasmaglobulins to form bradykinin. Effect mediated by release of ACH, acetylcholine, also causes release of vasoactive intestinal polypeptide, thus the effects being vasodilation in salivary glands, increased secretion from the eosinophil. So parasympathetic supply increases secretion from the eosinophil. So stimulation of sympathetic nerves, which are usually shorter and less strong, probable synergistic action causes secretion of small amounts of saliva rich in organic constituents and mucus from submandibular and sublingual glands. Salivary secretion increases either by taste of food within 20 to 30 seconds, that is innate reflex, by sight, smell or thought of food through conditioned reflex. So what are the factors altering salivary flow? Either the psychic factors, circadian rhythm, diurnal variation, age, drugs like TCA and phenothiazines, depression and anxiety states, dehydration and hemorrhage. So these are the factors altering salivary flow. Others are salivary gland diseases like radiation sialadenitis, autoimmune sialadenitis, HIV infection, iron overload, sarcoidosis, amyloidosis, cystic fibrosis. So what are the effects of drugs on salivary flow? Sympathomimetic drugs like adrenaline and ephedrine stimulate the salivary secretion. Parasympathomimetic drugs like ACTH, pilocarpine, muscarine and physostigmine increase the secretion of saliva. Histamine stimulates salivary secretion. Sympathetic depressants, that is opposite to sympathomimetic, they abolish the salivary secretion like ergotamine. Parasympathetic depressants like atropine and scopolamine inhibit the secretion of saliva. Anesthetics like chloroform and ether stimulate the reflex secretion of saliva. However, deep anesthesia decreases salivary secretion due to central inhibition. These are the factors altering the salivary composition, not secretion. Salivary composition will be altered through flow rate, source of secretion, the type of stimulus given, diurnal variation, the diet, drugs, flow dependent components, hormones like mineralocorticoids and ovulation. Disease states like sialadenitis, radiation damage, Sjögren syndrome, cystic fibrosis, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, alcoholic cirrhosis, aldosteronism and chronic pancreatitis. These all factors alter the salivary composition. Okay, thank you. Everyone of you have given your attendance in the chat box? Yes? One of you respond. Class year.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm closing the meeting.
Okay.